我今年见到乡村白马给啥子东包了？乡村这块我这里白马种的是啥的？过的我看着忙不过去，急急走到处去寻鸡，老不叫小时送给了白马似的。我这种个人咱们就当这不能挣钱，不就像是你有这边的？之前我不就老早老早了，都做寻鸡了，现在上一百几、上百元的把他们抓到的忙，我这做这种个人咱们就当这不能挣钱，不就像是你有这边当之前我不就老早了。虽然提出申请了，现在上一百七十三百元的八单，做单的忙，我都做了这种个人赚钱单，这不能挣钱不交，像是你这些单，这钱我就拿走了。虽然提出申请了，现在上一百七十三百元的八单，做单的忙，我都做了，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手。我忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙手动，忙把这个人帮忙。我忙把这个人帮忙手动，接拉到江苏了，带兵的到苏杭的那边，咱们江苏那当帮他做些活的，就当抓紧别人咋的说了，穷屯的广播家伙人样拉响咋了？刚刚露出的你，正着你的难道老三？今年冬干十三，有些人你记得个老老王在哪？刚到这边，坐了马人们都等我来解释。跟喇叭就打这样老这边等送，这都是接着你摸你老李接着着等着。马人们在这等我来捏个，今年正在拉车呢，等你到江苏平的松原等你走街这头。是朝知道是你沿着道路门虽然江湖了样了的的最终的季节接着我虽然道路的门门把着着你可当当就用路都把路住不必那我接得说娘姐前不走的你没想送你忙了前不安家把个人当安装都先没到东巴的街将来想在路
啊，各位师兄大家晚上好。
Good evening everybody.
啊，我们现在准备讲今天的课。
So we are now ready to begin this evening's teaching.
首先请大家发菩提心。
Before tonight's teaching, please everybody generate an aspiration of bodhicitta.
我们今天为什么要听这个课呢？就是我们想帮助所有的众生，也就是说我们下决心要让天下所有的众生解脱。为了达到这个目标，首先我自己要成佛。为了我成佛，我今天听这个课，这样子这个发心就叫做菩提心。
So by making the aspiration or generating the aspiration to assist in helping all beings transcend samsara.We dedicate ourselves to the attaining of Buddhahood. However, in order to achieve this, it's necessary that we learn and study. That is why we are attending this evening's teaching. So, this kind of aspiration, we are generating Buddhahood.
好，我们发了菩提心以后呢，我们就讲今天的这个课。那么今天的课，我们就是接着。昨天的这个禅修继续讲。
So having generated bodhicitta, we are going to move straight on to this evening's teaching, which is a continuation of what we were talking about last time.
那我们昨天我们讲的这个叫做极止，然后今天我们要讲的这个禅修就叫做升观。
So the kind of meditation that we spoke about yesterday evening was shamatha meditation or calm abiding meditation. And the type of meditation we are going to be looking at tonight is known as vipassana meditation or insight meditation.
那这两个有什么关系呢？昨天我们讲的跟今天的这个两个有什么关系呢？啊，首先，这个禅定啊，机智，就是我们的心啊，没有太多的杂念，然后平静啊，能够达到一个非常非常平静的状态啊，它没有这些动摇啊，这个部分啊，就叫做机智。
So in terms of what the connection or the relationship is between these two different aspects of meditation, or the kind of meditation that we spoke about last time, calm abiding meditation, is when our mind is resting in a very calm and tranquil state without too many discursive thoughts.
然后升观啊，升观是什么呢？那我们的心静下来了以后啊，就是要去证悟，要去明白啊，要去明白一些道理啊。那么，明白证悟的这个部分叫做升观。
And vipassana or meditation or insight meditation is on this basis of a calm and tranquil mind, coming to a realization of certain things, and this is what we refer to as insight.
比如说我们啊，点一盏灯啊，比如说一个蜡烛，这样子的时候呢，这个点了蜡烛以后，因为它的没有风的地方啊，那它就是燃烧的这个火焰啊，非常的平稳啊，没有动摇。那这个部分啊，就像这个寂止。
So if we were to imagine lighting a candle, say, in a space where there was no wind whatsoever, then the very still way that the flame would burn, we can liken this to calm abiding meditation, or the state of mind in the shamatha state.
然后这个蜡烛啊，它的火焰啊，这个一个一盏灯，那它有光啊，它发光啊，这个光的部分，光就像我们今天讲的这个升观的部分。
So the wick of the candle and its immediate flame we can liken to calm abiding meditation or the shamatha aspect of meditation. And the glow that the candle imparts.Around this flame, we can liken to the insight or compassion aspect of meditation.
那我们为什么要修这个寂止？就是因为我们的心很浮躁，这个幅度很大，这个要降下来，要达到一个平稳的这个水平就是为了这个。这个我们已经昨天讲得比较清楚了。
So the reason that we need to practice calm abiding meditation was that we explained yesterday evening that in the normal course of events, our minds are far too agitated. So in practicing shamatha meditation, we're bringing our minds into a state of calmness and tranquility.
然后我们今天讲的这个升观啊，那为什么要修这个升观？升观的作用它是什么呢？它的作用。就是我们那它作用就有两个不同的作用。
So why then, or what reason do we practice vipassana meditation or insight meditation? We can understand the purposes in doing so as twofold.
首先，第一个我们的现实生活当中，我们前几天讲的这些压力、焦虑、担忧。等等，很多很多的这些不开心不开心、不幸福这些负面的这些情绪它是来自于什么呢大多数都是因为我们有些事情我们想不通有些我们的心结打不开，就是在这种情况下发生的。
So the first of these reasons, again, as we spoke about last night or the night before, was that If we force our everyday lives, we have a lot of worry and stress and anxiety. And when we are in this state, we are not able to open our minds. Our minds are very closed when we are in this kind of afflicted state.
然后这个升官啊，有了这个升官以后呢，因为他比如说这个一盏灯，他不但是不动摇，而且他有光啊，这个光就可以这个周边都可以明亮啊，周边有什么东西看得很清楚。同样的，我们啊，就是有了这个升官的时候呢，我们明白了很多很多道理。很多问题我们相同了啊，然后呢，我们自己的心结打开了啊，这种情况下，然后我们啊可以把很多很多的这些担忧啊、焦虑啊这些东西全部可以这个消除啊，有这样子的作用。
So just as with a candle, the flame of the candle is very still, but the glow that it imparts allows us to see a lot, many, many things in the vicinity of the candle. So it is with Vipassana meditation. It enables us to open up the expanse of our mind and for us to understand and gain realization of many things.
然后第二个作用呢，就是汉传佛教的禅宗讲的这个明心见性啊，还有这个藏传佛教的大圆满大熟因啊，他们讲的真悟和开悟啊，就是要达到这个境界。
So, in so doing, being able to realize or understand a whole lot of things or phenomena the way things are, then we are potentially able to dispel our suffering. And also through the passion of insight meditation, it is possible for us to achieve the state of realization as referred to in the Chan tradition as realizing the nature of one's mind or awakening according to the
然后达到了这个境界的时候啊，它可不仅仅是能够消除我们的压力啊、担忧啊这些，而且贪嗔痴等这些烦恼啊，这些烦恼从本质上就可以铲除所以我们的这些所有的烦恼啊，证悟了以后呢。从本质上啊，从这个它的源头上就能够铲除，这个就是它的它的另外一个它的作用。
So not only is this kind of meditation able to dispel our worries and concerns and anxieties, it's actually possible through achieving awakening to eradicate.
然后这个我们在我们继续讲这个大佐的方法啊，有些因为我们昨天就因为时间的关系，就是有一些关于这个禅修的一些比较重要的事情，我们昨天没有来得及给大家讲，那么我今天要补充一下。
So like last night, due to time restraints, there were some important things that I didn't have time to explain properly. So tonight we're going to continue on with these things.
首先我们打坐的时候，这个昨天有一位师兄问到这个问题，我回答的时候也简单的说了一下首先我们打坐的时候，我们必须要有充分的这个思想准备。那什么思想准备呢？我们打坐的时候一定会这个有太多太多的杂念来干扰我们，这个一定会的似乎就是比我们不打坐的时候还多这些杂念每一个人都会有这样子的一段时间那这个我们必须要突破 如果没有这个思想准备的话，就是突破不了的。
So there was one person in the audience last night who asked a question about distracting thoughts and discursive thoughts that arise during meditation. And Kenpo said that this is in fact extremely normal, and it's extremely normal that we have a lot of discursive thoughts and a lot of distracting thoughts during meditation. It's necessary to be prepared, be mentally prepared to deal with these discursive thoughts as they arise. And if we're not properly prepared, then it will be very difficult for us to break through an inevitable phase when we will have to deal with them. It is possible to break through this initial phase or pass through it, but it's necessary that we be prepared.
我们打坐的时候啊，一开始打坐的时候，一开始静下来的时候啊，还没有来得及静下来的时候呢，然后有太多太多的杂念啊来干扰。那么我们刚才也讲了，时候就是比我们不打坐的时候还多啊，但是实际上呢，它不是我们不打比我们不打坐的时候更多，而且我们发现了我们有这么多的杂念。啊，我们不打坐的时候呢，因为我们没有注意有多少多少的杂念，我们根本就没有去关注它，所以呢，啊，就是我们自己没有发现而已。实际上，我们不打坐的时候，这个杂念是更多的。
So even though it seems when we sit down to meditation that distracting thoughts, the amount of them, the force with which they arise seems so much more than the way or the amount that we experience them in our normal non-meditative state. In actual fact, this isn't the case. It's just that when we sit down to meditate, we come to notice them more, we come to pay attention to them more than we do when we're not meditating.
很多人啊，就是不了解这种情况的人啊，他一开始打坐的时候，因为有太多太多的杂念，然后他以为啊，这个可能其他人都不会是这样子，因为我这是我个人的问题，啊，所以就像我可能对这个禅修没有因缘啊，所以我就不修了，我可能是修不下去，很多人是这样子啊，就推转了，推迟了，所以就过不了这个关啊，但是。我们必须要明白，这个不是我们个人的问题，这个我们绝大多数的人都是这样子，一开始的时候都这样子，所以必须要有勇气，这个时候必须要这个跨过这个阶段。
A lot of people when they begin to meditate and find themselves experiencing what the perspective was, they think it is just something that they as an individual are experiencing, and it's not something that everybody experiences when they begin to meditate. But this is far from the truth. In fact, dealing with distracting thoughts is an inevitable stage in progressing in one's meditation.On account of feeling that it's an individual problem, some meditators give up. They feel that they are not suited to meditation, so they don't persist. So at this stage, it's very important that we have enough courage to really push through this stage and transcend this period during which distracting thoughts seem so many and prolific.
然后我们要给大家介绍一下一个具体的一个禅修的方法。这个禅修的方法呢，我们昨天讲的这个寂止也需要这个方法啊，还有我们今天要讲的这个神观，它也需要这个方法。这个方法是寂止神观他们的共同的方法啊。接下来要给大家介绍一下这个方法。
So I'd like to introduce to everybody now a Vipassana meditation technique, but actually it's a method of meditation or a technique of meditation that is common to both Shamatha and Vipassana meditation styles.
那这个方法叫做九珠心 一二三四七八九九主，主就是我们的心，安主啊，主就是这个意思，九主心。
And this is, or they are the nine methods of bringing the mind to rest.
这个九主心呢，在汉传佛教的禅宗里面有九种不同的图来解释，这个图叫做九牛图，牛就是一个放牛的时候的一个放牧的一个过程啊，一个放牧的人去放他的牛，那这个过程就分了九个不同的过程啊，然后这叫做九牛图。
So the nine methods of bringing the mind to rest in Chinese Buddhism are illustrated in the form of nine pictures that showing a bull being tamed.
那这个九牛图啊，讲的都是禅宗讲的禅宗，那么他们讲的比较高深。
And these nine stages of taming the bull.Represent the nine methods in the Chan tradition, and they are teaching it quite hard.
那我们今天啊，这个九牛图里面呢，后面的这个我们暂时用不上，我们不讲，我们介绍前面的三个啊，一共是有九个方法，其中我们今天给大家介绍前面的三个，因为我们刚刚打坐初学的人。最需要的就是前面的三个。
So all these nine methods of bringing the mind to rest. Tonight we're going to talk about the first three. We're not going to go into the latter six. For the time being, as newcomers to meditation, the first three methods are what are most useful to us.
第一个叫做安住心啊，安住心就是。我们比如说我们去修禅定的时候啊，我们昨天大家都感受了，比如说我们去数呼吸的时候，然后我们的心啊，全身关注的去关注这个呼吸的这个数字啊，那么这个阶段叫做安住心，安住的意思就是把我们的心啊，我们的心在现实生活当中，我们是各种各样的这个杂念，然后它根本就没有一个规律啊！一会儿我们又想这个，一会儿又想那个，然后一会儿去思考过去，一会儿又去思考未来，它不规范啊，非常非常混乱的状态啊。那么把这个混乱的这个状态呢，把它规范起来，规范起来，最后让它去关注。一个脚垫啊，那这个时候呢，它叫做安住心。
So the first of the nine methods of bringing the mind to rest is called placement or placement of the mind. So just as last night, when we were looking at karma abiding meditation, we spoke about how when we are counting the breath through focusing on.The act of counting the breath, we bring our mind into a single point of concentration. This is what we refer to by placing the mind. So in the ordinary course of things, our mind is darting here and there, left and right, into the past and back into the future. So when we focus our mind on a single object of concentration and we place it there, then this is what we mean by placing.
还有一个，我们昨天有修了第二个这个禅定啊。第二个禅定呢，我们不是去数呼吸，我们把所有的这些杂念全部放下，然后就心里什么也不想啊，就这么去安住，把我们的两只眼睛就定啊某一个点，然后心啊，我们的心也就专注在这个点上面。然后呢，心里把所有心里的所有的杂念都放下，就在这个当中停留，这个停留的部分啊，这个部分叫做安住心啊，因为我们的心就是在这个地方安住了， 安住下来了，所以叫做安住心。
And then in the second kind of meditation that we practiced last night, where we brought our mind to focus on a single point, on the image of the Buddha, and let go of all our distracting and discursive thoughts, then for the period of time that we focused on this object, and abided in this state where of complete focus and no discursive thoughts,then this was also placement of the mind. Placement because we placed our mind, we placed our attention on the object of our focus undivided.
还有一个呢，除了我们昨天和今天的以外，前几天我们讲的这个四千心啊，那四千心它也是一种禅修，那么四千心它因为它也是禅修，所以我们现在讲的这个暗住心四千心它也是需要的那么四千心的这个暗住心是什么呢？比如说我们去思考我们的人生有多么多么难得，这样子的时候当我们去思考，特别的投入，特别认真的去思考的时候正在精心思考的时候，我们的心没有走神没有抛神，很专注的去思考的这个阶段叫做安住心。
We can also speak of placement of the mind in terms of the four outer preliminary contemplative practices that we talked about the other evening. So the outer preliminaries, the four contemplations that we do, they are also a form of meditation. They are a form of contemplative meditation. And so, for example, when we contemplate in a extremely focused and deep way,without discursive thoughts, without our mind wandering off in some direction, and give our mind entirely to contemplating, for example, the preciousness of our human life, then this also is placement of the mind.
好，这个就是我们有九个方法里面的第一个，就是安住心。我们去打坐的时候呢，首先我们把我们的心去让他去思考某一件事情，或者是让他什么都不要去想安静下来。这个我们到底去想还是不想，思考还是不思考，我们要看当时我们在修什么禅定有些禅定呢它是要思考的，有些禅定是没有思考的。我们很多时候有人问这个到底我们修禅定的时候要去想还是不想呢？那要想的话要去想什么呢？平时很多人都问这样子的问题。那这个回答是不能这么比如说我们说禅定是要去想或者是不去想不能这么回答，因为禅定有些是有思考的，有些是没有思考的，所以我们要把它分开讲但是不管是有思考的或者没有思考的都是一样的，就是首先我们的心静下来或者是去思考这个阶段就是安住心。首先我们修禅定的时候我们要把心安住下来这叫做安住心。
So there is some confusion among many people as to the different types of meditation, contemplative meditation or meditation techniques that involve contemplating and meditation techniques that don't involve contemplating. They involve bringing the mind into a state of calmness or tranquility. In either case, we can speak of placing the mind. So in terms of the preliminary practices, when we contemplate with undivided attention on a particular proposition, then this is considered placement of the mind. And so too in shamatha meditation, when we bring our mind to focus on a particular object, let go of the discursive thoughts, then this is also considered placement of the mind. So,Depending on the style of meditation that we are practicing, placing with the mind may entail contemplation or may not.
然后第二个方法，第二个方法叫做涉足行也叫做蓄足心，蓄就是积蓄的蓄我想如果我们用这个蓄足心的话比较好理解蓄足心就是我们连续继续打坐，比如说我们现在刚才把我们的心安住了，安住下来了，那安住了以后呢，让它继续停留在这个状态当中，不要让它离开这个意思叫做蓄足行。
The second of the nine methods of bringing the mind to rest is called continual placement. So, by continual placement, what we are speaking of is after having brought the mind into placement by focusing on a particular object, we continue to abide in this state. We continue to abide in this state and don't let our mind wander off.
但是我们再努力再让它继续也好我们的因为我们都是初学者，所以我们只能这个保持几分钟然后几分钟以后呢我们没有办法再继续下去的。
However, because of the fact that we are newcomers to meditation, regardless ofHow hard we might try, it's not possible for us to abide in this state endlessly. So after a few minutes of placement, it's inevitable that our mind will wander off somewhere.
为什么不能继续下去呢？就是因为我们这个时候呢，它又会冒出一个念头比如说我们心平静下来安住在这个状态当中持续几分钟一分钟两分钟五分钟的时候呢，然后他突然间冒出一个念头这个念头就把我们的这个禅修让它剪短破坏掉了，所以就没办法继续。
And the reason that we're not able to abide continually in this state is because after a few minutes, inevitably a thought will arise that will interrupt our state of meditation.
如果我们的禅修是有思维的这个禅修的话，比如说我们在思考人生难得这样子非常认真的去思考的时候呢，我们思考了几分钟以后，然后就逐渐的，他又开始去思考另外一个东西，跟我们的这个人生难得没有关系的完全就走神这叫做走神、跑神就他就去想另外一件事情这样子以后呢，我们没办法持续。
And in the context of contemplating on the outer preliminary practices.For example, when we are contemplating the preciousness of our human rebirth, after a few minutes, our mind will start thinking about something else entirely unrelated to that. This is called the mind wandering off.
然后第三个第三个这个方法叫做解足行，解就是要调节我们的心抛身了以后呢，那我们必须要把它拿回来，把它带回来，要调节。如果不调节的话，那让它继续这样子下去那我们没办法打坐了。我们只有开始的时候就只有打了几分钟的坐，然后它就自己去胡思乱想，然后就想的都是根本跟我们的禅修是没有关系的东西。所以这个时候必须要调节必须要调节，所以叫做。解诸行。
And the third method of bringing the mind to rest is repeated placement. And this refers to bringing the mind back to the object of concentration after it has wandered off. It is inevitable, as we just said, that the mind will do this. It will begin thinking about this or that unrelated to the object of our meditation. And then bringing it back to focus.We engage in repeated placement of the mind.
请大家要记好记住啊，基本上我们的禅修的这个整个的过程基本上就这三个啊。第一个我们啊专心的去安住，然后呢安住下来了以后呢，我们尽量的去保持啊维持这个现在的这个状态。然后呢第三个啊，他一定会走神的，他一定，我们再努力他一定会走神，因为我们的禅定的功夫不够，所以呢他一定会走神跑神啊。跑神的时候呢，我们要把他抓回来，抓回来让他继续去想这个事情啊，或者是让他继续安住啊。整个的禅修的过程啊，在初期阶段的时候呢，整个的过程基本上就是这三个。
So everybody, please make note of these three methods of bringing the mind to rest. At the initial stage of our meditation, essentially these three methods characterize the entirety of our meditative process. So starting out by bringing the mind into placement, bringing it to focus on an object of concentration or contemplation, doing our best to remain in this state through continual placement, and then when the mind inevitably wanders off in some other direction, bringing it back to into placement again on the object of concentration or contemplation with repeated placement.
好，这个当中啊，我们要注意啊，两件事情是非常重要的。整个过程当中
，And in the process of all of this, there are two things that we need to pay attention to that are very important.
一个叫做正直啊，第二个叫做正念啊，正直正念，这两个是整个的这个禅修的过程当中不能缺少的，特别重要。
These two things are referred to as mindfulness and awareness.
正知和正念啊是什么呢？首先，正念是什么意思呢？比如说我们啊去思考这个人生啊难得啊，这个时候，这个人生难得啊，这个内容啊。一直都在我们的心里，它还没有离开我们的心啊。也就是说，我们的心一直都在这个人，在思考这个人生难得。我们的心没有把这个人生难得忘掉啊，一直都在我们的心里啊。这叫做正念。念是什么意思呢？就是回忆啊，就是把这个没有，把这个所修的东西没有忘掉。叫做正念。
So by mindfulness, we mean when we don't let a particular thought leave our mind. We don't let ourselves forget it. So when during the preliminaries we're contemplating the preciousness of human existence, and by keeping this thought in our mind, not letting go of it, this is mindfulness.
比如说我们的心啊，就安住在这个寂止啊，寂止无念的这个状态当中，我们什么也不想，静下来，心里特别特别啊安静啊。那这个时候，我们的心还没有离开这个安静的这个状态的时候呢，我们啊有正念。已经有正念了啊，因为我们还没有忘掉他一直都，我一直都在想，或者是我一直都没有离开这个境界，所以就是有正念啊。然后呢，我们的心里就产生了一个念头啊，然后念头出来了以后呢，这个安静啊，这就已经不存在了，然后已经我们的心已经去思考其他的问题了啊，然后就有很多的杂念、胡思乱想。这个时候在我们的心里啊，这个平静安静这个部分呢已经不存在了，所以这个时候呢可以说我们已经把这个状态忘掉了啊，忘掉了，忘记了，所以这个时候呢叫做没有 正念啊，没有正念。
And when we are doing shamatha meditation, we are abiding in calmness, abiding in tranquility. Then when we're in that state, we say that we are mindful or have no mindfulness. But we are still abiding in this state. However, when a discursive thought arises that interrupts this state so that we are no longer in it, then we can speak of no longer having mindfulness.
好，第二个就叫做正直。那正直是什么意思呢？就是我们打坐的时候，非常清醒的指导自己的状态啊。我现在是在打坐，还是我在胡思乱想啊？我现在的这个状态是出于禅定的状态，还是出于？啊，胡思乱想的这个状态啊，这个过程啊，这个情况特别特别的清楚，自己特别清楚，这个叫做正智。
And awareness is our cognizance of the state that we are in. So it's being aware of whether we are in a state of meditative concentration or whether we are thinking about something entirely unrelated.It's a meta-awareness or a meta-cognizance of our mental activity.
如果没有这个正智，没有正智的话，那是一个什么样的情况呢？比如说我们打坐啊，一开始的时候就已经很好，状态不错啊，然后慢慢慢慢的，他就走神啊，走神啊，就去想很多很多跟禅修。没有关系的事情啊，但是我根本就没有发现啊，我自己根本没有发现，我以为还在打坐哦，身体呢还是这个禅定的这个姿势啊，我以为一直都在打坐，但是呢，实际上我的心啊已经很早就已经离开了他的这个状态，已经根本就不在打坐，他在胡思乱想啊，但是我没有发现啊。为什么没有发现？就是因为我没有正智啊，不知道，我不知道，不明白他已经离开了。那这是我们的禅定的一个最大的问题。
So not having awareness is, or not being aware is when we are seated in a meditative posture, we're seated in meditation, we think we're still meditating, but already our thoughts have wandered off, we're thinking about things entirely unrelated to our meditation, and yet we're not aware of this fact. We think or presume that we are still in the process of meditating. So this, lack of awareness is one of the greatest challenges that we experience in meditation.
那我们可以这么说啊，禅定的时候就是三个阶段，两个方法啊，这个记住就可以了。三个阶段是我们刚才讲的啊，按住心，然后就是续住心。然后解烛心，这个是我们的禅定的三个过程。然后两个工具，或者是两个，就这个就像一个工具一样，调节的调节我们自己心态的一个就像工人的工具一样。那这个是两个方法，那两个不同的方法，一个叫做正直，一个叫做正念啊，三个阶段，两个方法。
So please make note then of there being three phases, placement, continual placement, and repeated placement, and two techniques or two tools through which we are engaging our meditation, and they are mindfulness and awareness. So three stages and the two tools.
好，然后打坐的时候啊，打坐的时候这个。正念和正直啊，我们怎么样应用啊？怎么样实际上我们怎么去用呢？啊，我们的心专注在这个这个状态当中，一直去思考，或者是还没有走神的时候呢，已经有了这个正念啊，正念已经有了，不需要 单独的不需要单独的去做什么，这个真言已经存在了。只要我们所修的东西啊，没有离开我们的心啊，或者是我们的心没有离开我们要修的这个境界啊，这样子真言已经具备了。
So how do we go about using these tools then? Well, in terms of the first mindfulness, then as long as we are in a state of meditative concentration, or as long as we are focused on the object of our meditation, then it's not necessary for us to do any extra to cultivate mindfulness. As long as we are in this state or focused undividedly on the object of our meditation, then we mindful or in possession of mind.
然后正直啊，他始终就是要这个见识自己的这个禅修的状态，见识或者是监督啊，监督啊，因为有了这个正直的时候呢，他时时刻刻都在见识我的这个禅修的状态对还是不对。啊，他在监视，他在监督啊，所以这个就是运用的时候呢，我们用正知来监视啊，或者也可以说监督。
And awareness is that which monitors or checks our state during meditation. It's what keeps an eye on whether we are focused on our object of meditation or distracted by something else.So it achieves a monitoring or a checking function.
然后这个见识怎么样见识呢？啊，这个我在这个回灯之光，我们昨天提的这本书里面呢，好几个地方都反复的讲过了啊。我们现在就是用一个词汇，就叫做侧面的啊，侧面的去见识，不要正面的去见识啊。那什么叫侧面的，或者是？正面的呢，比如说我们打坐的时候啊，我很平静的打坐的时候，然后我心里就是产生了一个念头，哎，我这个打坐是不是对呀？我现在有没有周身呢？我现在有没有平静的状态啊？我有没有停留在这个平静状态？这样子直接这么去想，这叫做正面的这个见识啊。那么这个正面的见识呢，它明明就是一个念头，那这个念头实际上已经打断了我们的平静的状态，所以不能有这样子的正面的见识。
So in terms of how we go about checking or monitoring our state of meditation, I've explain this in quite a lot of detail in the Wisdom Light book series that I was telling you about last night. We have a particular kind of vocabulary to describe how we go about checking or monitoring our meditative state. We call this checking peripherally, as opposed to checking straight on. And what checking straight on would be is if during meditation we were to ask ourselves directly, am I in a state of meditation? Have my thoughts wandered off? Am I still in a state of calmness? If we ask ourselves this question in a direct kind of way, then actually it's really just manifesting a discursive thought. So it's completely interrupting our meditative state.
那侧面的这个监视啊的方法是什么样子呢？因为我们的心啊，我们的心它有两个不同的功能啊，一个功能它对外可以去感受这个外面的世界，另外一个它的作用呢，它同时也就特别的清楚它自己的状态，它自己的本质啊，它很清楚的。比如说我们的眼睛啊，可以看到外面的东西，但是呢，我们不是很知道它的眼球的里面是什么样子，我们没办法知道。但是我们的心就不一样了，我们的心它同时可以感受外来的这些幸福、痛苦、快乐等等，同时它就知道我现在我自己的内心的感觉是什么，他也特别的清楚啊，他就有对外对内的两个不同的这个 功能。那这个功能在佛教里面，这叫做自知之明啊，自知之明。我们的很多物质啊，物质它都是没有这个自知之明的功能啊，今生就有自知之明的啊这个功能，自知自明，就是说他非常清楚他自己的状态是什么样子啊。比如说我们特别特别难受的时候啊，如果我们不注意这个念头的话，那我们啊就不知道我们的难受，什么叫做难受，我们不知道的。如果我们稍微注意一下啊，难受的时候啊，他的我的这个心啊，我的精神的状态是什么样子，稍微注意一下，然后他就知道什么叫做难受啊。一方面他可以感受外来的这个这些痛苦快乐，另外一方面呢，他正在感受痛苦和快乐的状态是什么样子，他也知道啊。那这个叫做自知之明。
So the distinguishing capacity of the mind as opposed to other organs, for example, the eye is able to perceive external phenomena in the world, but it's not able to see into its internal organ. The mind is different to this. The mind is special in that it can perceive phenomena in the outside world whilst also remaining cognizant of its own inner perceptions and sensations and feelings. And in respect of this ability of the mind to be aware of its own workings and feelings and thoughts and so on, we call it self-knowing or self-cognizant. So for example, when we have a feeling of suffering or pain or unpleasantness, we are able to not only, if we are not looking deeply into our mind, then we may not be so clear about the nature of this feeling. However, if we direct the mind back in on itself, then it's possible for the mind to be extremely cognizant aware of what the sensation or what the sense of this pain and suffering is. So this meta-awareness or meta-cognizance of the mind exists simultaneously with its ability to perceive the phenomena in the world.
好，那么这个用这个自知之明来监督自己的内在的状态啊，怎么样这个怎么样去监督呢？比如说我们打坐这个机制，我们心静下来心里没有任何的杂念，非常平静的时候，同时我们要注意不要直接的去思考这个对还是不对，不能这么去思考，同时就是要注意长时间的这个注意他的状态，他有没有周身啊，有没有这个昏沉啊，他有没有昏沉，有没有周身，这个要注意啊，侧面的注意。比如说我要看这瓶水啊，这瓶水，那我的眼睛直接头转过去这么看啊，那就叫做正面的。那侧面的就是说我不转过去，头不转过去，我往前看啊，但是我同时要注意，可以注意这瓶水啊，我虽然没有往这边看，但是呢有人来动的时候呢我还是知道的啊，有人来动这瓶水我还是感觉得到，这个我可以我的眼睛可以注意到这个啊，就是这种方法啊，我们直接的就不要去想啊，但是呢侧面的静下来了以后呢，侧面的，那我们只能用这种语言啊，我不知道这个表达清楚了没有，只能这么讲，这就是一个禅修的方法。目前我们用的比较准确的这个词汇，我觉得应该是叫做侧面的去监督啊。的正面和侧面我刚才已经讲清楚了啊，就是我虽然没有看这瓶水，我在看前面的东西， 但是呢，我的这边眼角上我也可以注意到这个，有人来动的时候，我平时都看得见啊。如果我没有注意到它，我的眼睛在往前看，有人把这瓶水拿走了，我根本就不知道什么时候拿走啊。同样的道理，我们的心不要直接的去扰乱它，但是呢，侧面的去留意它的状态。
So we use this self-cognizing, self-cognizant or self-aware capacity of the mind to monitor the state of our mind or check the state of our mind during meditation. And we do this, as mentioned just before, in a peripheral way and not a straight-on or direct way. So in a peripheral way, we check whether or not our mind has wandered off, whether it's in a state of distraction, whether it's in a state of dullness. And we can liken this to the bottle sitting on the table over there. So when we are looking ahead, not looking at it in a straight, we're not turning around to look at it, we were turning around to look at it, we would be looking at it directly. Rather, looking ahead, we can still see in our peripheral vision if someone could come away and take away that bottle. So it's a similar kind of idea with meditation. Whether or not this language describes things clearly enough, probably the notion of checking peripherally and or checking directly is the best we can do to approximate or come close to an understanding of what we're doing at this point in meditation.
这个正面和侧面啊，这种词汇它不是一个佛教的专用词，它不是一个佛教里面的标准的词，就是为了大家理解啊，我们就怎么讲，不知道说清楚了没有？大家说清楚了吗？清楚了啊，好，非常好。
So this idea of checking, monitoring straight on, directly or peripherally, this isn't a.technical Buddhist vocabulary, it's a kind of way of describing things that we've come up to provide convenience to meditators. I don't know whether or not I've explained this clearly. Have I?
正知正念就是这两个啊，就这两个。然后呢，我们除了这个以外，然后我们有很多很多的禅定，比如说小乘佛教里面呢，有一个叫做四念处，四念处啊。那这个跟我们的前几天讲的这个藏传佛教的这个四个加心啊，有些内容呢完全是一样的，基本上是差不多的。
So these two concepts regarding two approaches or methods, tools in respect of meditation.Beyond, aside from these, there are many others. In the Theravada tradition, we can speak of four levels of meditation that are similar to what we described in the preliminaries the other evening.
那么这个正知正念的这个修法啊，现在西方非常的流行，很多很多地方都特别的流行。那这个正知正念呢，实际上这个修法就是我们刚才讲的这些了，这叫做这叫，其实这个不叫正知正念的修法，这个叫做寂知的修法。那么正知正念呢，那其中两个调节的方法，其中两个比较重要的环节。
So what we've just described, mindfulness and awareness or mindfulness meditation is extremely popular in the West these days. In actual fact, it's in its essence a kind of shamatha meditation.
好，还有一个非常重要的一个呢，我们比如说我们修这个寂止打坐的时候这样子静下来的时候呢，就感觉特别特别好的时候啊，就是说我们自己感觉心特别的平静啊，没有任何的这个杂念，特别平静，这样子的时候，我们感受到这个的时候呢，然后立即就停下来， 端简短听下来。听下来啊，就是听下来，对不对？嗯，就是这样子啊。我们打坐的时候啊，就是我们感觉特别特别好的时候，就是我们的心非常平静的时候，我们自己感觉到特别平静的时候呢，然后就不要继续下去，听下来，间断。
There's also another approach when that we can apply when we are meditating, when we are in a state, or when we reach the state of extreme calmness and tranquility, and we deliberately don't continue, we deliberately cut or interrupt this state.
我们很多人不理解为什么这个时候最好的时候要停下来呢？最好的时候不就是一直这样子持续下去，不就是最好吗？为什么要停下来呢？很多人会有这样子的疑问。当时为什么要停下来的理由就是说，如果这个时候如果我们自己不懂得主动的停下来的话，那么再往后一点点的时候呢，然后马上就有一个念头出来把它剪断了这个是很被动的，所以呢我们自己主动把这个时候要剪断。
So many people wonder why we do this when we're in the arguably the best state of our meditation, why we would purposely abort it, why we would purposely interrupt it. And the reason we do this is that if we did continue in this state of meditation, then very soon a discursive thought would arise, which would interrupt our meditation anyway. And because this would be, from our point of view, passive, it wouldn't be us interrupting our meditation through our own volition. Therefore, we adopt this preemptive approach of cutting or interrupting our meditation ourselves.
好，间断了以后呢，然后立即又进入这个状态立即就进入这个状态，又去打坐然后打坐状态特别好的时候呢，又主动的间断停下来然后停下来了以后呢，然后又立刻又去打坐然后打坐感觉特别好的时候，特别平静的时候，效果特别好的时候，又把它间断停下来，就是这样子，整个过程都是这样子。
And then upon interrupting our meditation, we immediately bring our minds back to the object of our concentration. And then abiding in calmness again, when we are in our most calm state, our most tranquil state, again interrupt. And then immediately bring our minds back to it. So by repeating this process,
为什么要这样子呢因为我们自己，因为我们感觉特别好的时候，自己停下来，主动的停下来的话，然后下一次再修这个禅定的时候，我们特别有兴趣特别感兴趣很想再去感受一下这种感觉有很有这种积极性。
One advantage of doing this is that by proactively or by our own volition interrupting our meditation, then when we bring our mind back to the focus of our attention again, we are very enthusiastic, but very motivated.
如果不这样子停下来的话，那我们因为我们的禅定的功夫不到位，所以呢。就我们自己不停下来，那就是也就一会儿，就是有一个杂念来间断我们的这个禅定的状态，来干扰的。那每一次这样子那虽然我们在这个中间的阶段的感受比较好，但是呢，每一次最后的时候呢，有一个念头被动的这个断掉破坏，这样子的话，那我们。这个对禅修就慢慢就是不感兴趣有这样子的问题，所以呢要主动停下来。
And the reason we do this is that as beginners, and because our meditation activity, our school is not yet stable or completely honed, every time that a discursive thought arises and interrupts our meditation, then despite the fact that it is possible for us to have quite good experience of calmness and tranquility in the spaces of time between discursive thoughts, every time they interrupt us, they essentially cause us to increasingly feel disinterested in the process or the activity of meditation.
比如说两个人聊天啊，聊天聊得特别好的时候就不聊了啊，那这样子以后呢，间断啊，停下来，然后就特别想去再聊啊，再聊天，就是这个意思。
So it's just like two people who are having a conversation, they're having a really nice talk, and then suddenly all of a sudden they interrupt their conversation, and they just at the point where they are really enjoying it, and by doing this they will be able to continue a very strong desire to have conversation in the future.
如果这个时候不停下来啊，一开始聊得很好，但是最后呢就慢慢聊着聊着觉得很无聊啊，这样子以后呢下次不想再聊了。
If they weren't to interrupt their conversation suddenly, then they just continue on talking to each other until they got to a point where they both felt rather bored. But by interrupting it very suddenly, they preserve interest on both sides for conversing with each other again in the future.
所以我们早起的时候呢，禅定的功夫不是很好的时候，可能需要三分钟、五分钟这样子的时间就要间断，甚至是更短的时候就要停下来。
So for this reason, when we're just starting out with our meditation, it's good for us to interrupt ourselves in this way every 3 to 5 minutes, or perhaps even more often than this.
然后。啊，我们的这个禅定的功夫就逐渐的啊，就功夫越来越好，逐渐的好起来的时候呢，然后我们把这个时间可以延长啊，10分钟停下来，7分钟停下来啊，就是这样子，逐渐的间断，然后最后呢，15分钟再停一次啊，20分钟停一次，最后就半个小时都可以一直都可以停留。最后可以达到这种状态。
So in the very beginning, it's advisable for us to do this very frequently, every few minutes. But as our meditation skill increases, then we gradually extend the period of time between the interruption of our meditation. So we can extend from 7 minutes to 10 to 15 until.When our meditation skills are really developing, perhaps half an hour.
早起的时候啊，我们打坐的这个停下来的这个次数要多啊，时间要短。
So in the early phase of our meditation, we.Need to interrupt ourselves frequently and have a relatively short space between each interruption.
吼起的时候呢，停下来的次数就可以慢慢的越来越少，然后中间的这个停留的时间就可以越来越延长。
And as we become more advanced, we can interrupt ourselves less frequently, and the period of time between interruptions can become longer.
这是一个非常好的一个训练的方式啊。我们修禅定实际上就是一种锻炼啊，锻炼自己的精神啊。那这个锻炼就需要有方法。如果没有方法，我们直接什么也不想，我们以为这个是打坐，其实很难成功的。
So this is an extremely good way for training the mind. But in terms of training the mind, we need methods, we need concrete techniques. just sitting down in meditation and thinking that this will do it, it's highly unlikely that we will experience good results.
好，接下来我们给大家介绍一下我们在参修的过程当中遇到的几个问题和解决的方法。
So I'd now like to address several common problems that we experience during the course of meditation and how we can go about addressing them.
那遇到的问题呢，一般是我们比较可能遇到的问题呢，就有三种问题，一个。是开始的时候遇到的问题另外两个呢我们后期的时候在经常会遇到另外两个呢经常会遇到
So of these three likely challenges that we might encounter the first one is one that we are more likely to encounter at the beginning of our meditation and the other two are ones that we are likely to frequently encounter in more advanced stage
好，开始的时候，第一个问题我们刚才已经讲过了，就是会有我们会遇到一个非常混乱的这个状态，特别特别杂念特别多这个我们刚才已经讲过了，这个就是开始的时候我们遇到的问题。然后解决的方法呢，我们刚才也讲过，要有充分的这个思想准备，要坚持解决的方法就是这个实际上我们已经介绍过了。
So the first one is, and we've already spoken about it this evening, during our beginning involvement with meditation, our beginning phase of meditation, experiencing a great velocity and frequency of distracted thoughts. And the way that we go about addressing this, we have already talked about, it's being sufficiently mentally prepared for this to happen,continuing to persist with courage in our meditation. This is essentially how we pass through this stage.
好，然后我们禅修的时候经常遇到的两个问题第一个叫做魂嗔。
The second common problem that we encounter during meditation is dullness, mental dullness.
魂嗔就是我们打坐的时候工作压力大的时候很累的时候人非常疲惫的情况下打坐或者是晚上吃饭吃得特别饱然后再去打坐在这种情况下一会儿就睡着了这个叫做魂嗔还没有睡着但是呢就是特别的昏沉就是没有什么干手昏昏沉沉的这个是我们经常遇到的一个问题。
So dullness is that semi-sleep-like state that we experience when we sit down to meditation after a long day of work, we're feeling extremely tired, we're feeling exhausted, or when we sit down to meditate after having eaten a heavy meal. So this feeling of dullness or tiredness, it's not complete sleep, is a problem that we regularly encounter in meditation.
Not-这个问题我们怎么样解决呢有几个简单的方法这个简单的方法来解决第一个我们打坐的这个地方的室内的这个光线要亮一点比如说我们把窗帘拉开等等光线越亮越好的这个时候
So one simple way of addressing this is toensure that the space that we're meditating in is as bright as possible so we can open the curtains or turn on the light.
然后就室内的温度要降低比如说空调开得低一点稍微冷一点有帮助。
Or reduce the temperature of the room in which we're meditating such as turning on the air conditioner.
如果有这种条件的话比如说我们住两层楼三层楼这样子的话那就到楼顶上或者是最上面的一层楼稍微比较高的地方去打坐这个时候有帮助但是呢我们不一定每一个人都有这个条件假如有的话可以这样子。
If you happen to live in a health and health stories, then it can be beneficial to go to the topmost floor of your house and meditate. But this is something clearly that everybody will have the choice to do.
还有一个比较有用的是，我们这个时候呢就站起来啊，用凉水啊冲一下，就是凉水洗一下脸，有帮助的。
Or another useful thing we can do is to splash our face with some cold water.
然后衣服穿少一点，不要太厚。
And wear lighter clothes, not dress too warmly.
如果这些全部都用了还是不解决的话，那就暂时不要打坐。
And if you try all of these methods of addressing the problem of dullness and it doesn't do anything, then for the time being, give up meditation.
比如说，我们本来有一个小时的这个功课做功课的时间啊，那么。前面的十多分钟的时候呢，这个浑身实在是没办法解决，那就剩下来的五十分钟、四十分钟，那我们去磕头啊、念经啊、做别的功课，只能这样子，不能强迫自己。
So if we reserve an hour for practice and the first 10-15 minutes of meditation, see us experiencing continual dullness, then we can.Abandon meditation for this session and spend the time instead doing something else like prostrations or chanting mantras.
我们调伏我们自己的心态啊，我们这个调整我们的心，也就是锻炼我们的心，就像驯服动物一样的啊。比如说驯服动物的时候呢，驯服时啊，熏香，比如说大香，熏香时啊，它一方面打啊，但是呢不是全部打，有些时候呢给它东西吃啊，这样大香最后大香也会跳舞，最后大香什么都会做的。
So the process of training our mind is just like taming an animal. The tamer of an animal, like an elephant, uses different methods. Sometimes they beat the animal, and sometimes they offer it treats and things to eat.And then in the end, by applying both of these methods, the animal can be successfully tamed, elephants can dance and do all kinds of tricks.
如果这个时候我们啊不懂得啊这个放松或者是强迫自己的话啊，强迫自己去打坐的话，那么我们的心就是会开始叛逆啊，越强迫它越不，最后越不想打坐。最后呢，就是我们看到这个打坐的这个地方啊，他就心烦啊。这个打坐，比如说我们在佛堂里面打坐的话，那这样子强迫的话，最后看到这个佛堂的门哦，心烦，不想进去啊，不想进去，这样烦叛逆的，所以不能这样子强迫啊，不能过急。
So if we try to force ourselves excessively to meditate, then this will only cause our mind to rebel against the task of meditation. And this can get to a point where even seeing the space that we usually meditate, or seeing the door of the room to our shrine that we usually meditate, will generate a great feeling of aversion or annoyance in us. So it's important that we don't compel ourselves in an excessive way.
好，这是一个。第二个，我们禅修的时候经常遇到的另外一个问题啊，用佛教的话来讲，这叫做吊局啊，吊局。那吊局的意思就是说散乱啊，我们的心散乱。打坐的时候，有些时候呢，就一开始打坐的时候就开始散乱啊，就是胡思乱想，根本就没办法静下来啊，心根本就静不下来。然后呢？越想打坐越想静下来，但是呢太多太多的这个杂念满天飞啊，静不下来，那这个叫做散乱，这个也是一个常见的问题。
And then the third common problem that many meditators encounter is distractedness, so a distracted mind. When we sit down to meditation, our minds are wandering off in every possible direction. Our minds are full of discursive thoughts of all natures. This is what we refer to as a state of distractedness or distraction.
好，这个时候的方法啊，解决的方法跟我们前面讲的相反的啊，相反的方法，比如说室内的灯光啊，光线要暗一点啊，然后呢，空调温度稍微要高一点，如果有条件的话，就到底层啊，一楼去打坐等等，就是前面的相反的。
The way that we go about addressing this kind of problem is the opposite of the way that we go about addressing dullness. So we can adjust the light in the space that we're meditating to a more dim light, a darker light. We can and go to a lower story of the house in which we're meditating and adjust the temperature so that it is warm.
Oh, 这个啊，这些方法都用了啊，但是还是静不下来的话，那我们跟前面讲的一样，就暂时就不打坐，我们去做别的事情。
So if we've done all these things and it doesn't really make any difference, then just as we were talking about before, the time being, don't meditate, spend the time with something else.
如果我们每一次打坐的时候都是这样子，比如说连续一周、两周都是这样子的话，那这个就实际上就是有其他的问题了。那这个时候有可能我们要调整饮食啊，或者是到中医。就看看一下中医这个身体有问题。中医啊，中医比较有办法这个。
If we continue to experience these problems for an extended period of time, for say a couple of weeks, every day for a couple of weeks, then this would suggest that we have other things going on, in which case we might need to adjust our diet or go and see a Chinese doctor or something.
好，这些都是我们常见的问题啊。另外一个呢，还有一个就是不是常见的问题，但是呢，对于有些人来说呢，也是一个问题。比如说，我们打坐的时候呢，有很多很多的这些幻觉啊，有很多的，有些人认为有什么声音在告诉他什么呀，有些人觉得自己的身体有什么反应啊，有异常的反应呢、或者看到什么东西呀，听到什么呀，如果有这种现象，这个一般都不会有的啊、如果有的话，也不是什么问题了。解决的方法啊，如果有这样子的问题，我们不要去管它，不要去理它，那这样子它自己会自生自灭。这个我们心静下来的时候呢，就是可能就生理上、心理上有一点点反应而已，这个其实不会有问题的，不要去执着它，它就自生自灭了。
These three problems that we've talked about are commonly encountered problems. There are also a few other problems that are less encountered, but if encountered might bother people, such as, for example, when one sits down to meditate, experiencing all kinds of various kinds of hallucinations or visions or bodily sensations and so on. If this does happen, one shouldn't pay it excessive attention or become extremely attached to this state. If we let it be, then these feelings or sensations or experiences will cease of their own momentum.
那基本上就是禅修的方法呢，基本上我们初学者的禅修的方法基本上都是这样子。接下来我们再给大家介绍一下这个升观这个部分。
So, this brings us to the conclusion of the basic common ground to both the shamatha and the passion practice. And in the time that we have remaining, I'd like to go into the actual passion or inside aspect of this practice.
因为我们时间的关系啊，就是这几天，这个本来我们安排的这些课程呢，没有办法全部讲完，讲的不是很圆满。
On account of the fact that we only have a few days to give these teachings, our time is somewhat restricted, so it's not possible to.Outline everything and describe everything in a complete way.
如果我们真的啊，对这个禅修，还有这个佛教的这些真正的这些修心啊，感兴趣的话，那我们需要系统的学习，系统的训练。
If we're really interested in learning more about Buddhism and meditation techniques, then it's important for us to.Both study and train ourselves in a systematic manner.
我们悉尼这边呢，就是开了一个禅修的这个班，有一个叫做禅修班。
In Sydney, there is a new class, meditation class.
那这个禅修班里面呢，我们可以系统的学习，还有系统的修心。
And in this meditation class, it is possible to study and practice in a systematic way.
那我们这两天讲的这些内容啊，全部都就从头到尾系统的这个禅修班里面会讲的。
So the contents that we discussed in these few nights of teaching in the meditation class will be.Gone over from the beginning in a completely thorough and detailed way.
然后很多的课呢，有些课是我们这样子可以面对面的讲，然后大部分的呢，我在中国大陆讲，然后呢，我们其他的人呢，在海外的，就是通过网络学习，然后每一步的这个禅修的方法讲完了以后呢。然后就去修一个两个月，然后下一次再讲，就是这样子。
And so the curriculum is based on teachings like tonight that I'm giving face to face, or teachings that I have given in other places overseas or in China. And then after I have given the teaching, they're filmed, and students can watch the teachings and then.
还有每一周都有几个师兄，比如说七个八个十个聚在一起，然后大家看这个视频，然后就讨论最后大家共修每一周都有一个这样子的活动。
And this class format also involves a weekly meeting of a small group of students, up to 7 or 8 students, who get together, watch teaching, discuss its contents, and then do group practice together.
然后如果你们自己感兴趣的话，那自己的身边的朋友或者是家里的家庭的成员七个八个十个或者是十几个大家可以聚在一起这样子学习。
So if any of you are interested, then it's possible for you to gather together other people around you who are interested, family members or friends, 10 people or more people, and to form a group of yourself.
如果我们当中就有如果有人愿意修的话，那就我们可以给这个主持人这边报名，然后到时候我们把这些资料这个学习的资料会发给大家的。
So if you are interested in this, please let tonight's MC know, and we will be in touch. and all you the love that studied here.
否则的话，我们因为就虽然是我们有五天的时间，但是呢，五天的时间当中，就是因为我们每一天，都要花一些时间，就是把每一天的课都当天的安排的这个课都是讲不完。
So despite the fact we have five days of teaching during this teaching session in Australia, because the contents of each night's teaching is quite a lot, it's really not possible for every single topic to fully be done justice in one night's teaching.
今天我们把这个禅修的方法呢，稍微比较详细的给大家介绍了。今天啊，昨天的这个记制的部分啊，昨天没有讲完的，我们今天补充了，那就是稍微应该是比较全面的。
So last night, for example, the calm abiding or samatha meditation introduction, I wasn't able to finish completely, so I elaborated on it further into that class. So in respect of this teaching.It's a quite complete set of instructions that I.
但是我们学的初学者呢不是直接就修这些禅定就是要修我们前两天最开始的那两天头两天讲的这些这个潜心从潜心开始一步一步的修。
However, since we are newcomers, beginners, the very beginning practices, the very beginning contemplative meditation practices we should start with are those that I outlined on the first two nights of teaching, the four outer preliminary practices. This is where we should start our meditation.
如果我们喜欢修昨天和我们今天讲的这个机制有些人比较喜欢禅修的话，那就我们修这个潜心的同时，也安排一些时间修这个禅定也可以的。
But if you're someone who enjoys or likes practicing the shamatha meditation technique that I described last night, then it is.Fine to allocate time for this practice at the same time as you are working on the preliminaries.
接下来我们给大家介绍我们的今天的这个主题，就是升观这个部分。现在时间已经超过了，但是呢，就是这个，就是因为我们今天的主题要给简单的给大家介绍一下。
So even though we're already over the time tonight, we're still going to just use the remaining few minutes that we do have left to talk about Vipassana, which is or was tonight's teaching topic.
好，这个升观有特别特别多的方法，这方法特别多，然后呢？这些内容也相当的多那我们今天给大家介绍一个比较简单的方法。
So in respect of Vipassana, there are a tremendous variety of different techniques that are all very different in their content and approach. And so what I would like to introduce to you tonight is a very simple Vipassana technique.
好，这个我们比如说我们特别的难受的时候，特别难过的时候，就是因为什么其他的原因非常非常难受的时候，通常我们只懂得去感受这个难受，很痛苦很难受，但是我们不懂得去看什么叫做难受，我们一般不会，谁都不会这么去做的。
When we are feeling extremely unhappy or upset, usually we only know to experience the feeling of being upset or unhappy. We don't understand how to observe the state of being upset.
啊，如果我们学一下啊，学一下这个方法，然后自己稍微锻炼一下，很多时候啊，我们自己的一般的这些，难受、不开心啊、焦虑、担忧等等，还有压力这一类的东西啊，自己很简单的就解决了。
But if we are able to train ourselves in the ability to do this, to observe the state of our mind when it's experiencing this kind of feeling, then in many situations, our unhappiness, feelings of being upset and anxious, worried, etc., can be essentially eradicated or done away with very easily.
啊，这个有三个步骤。
And there are three steps.
第一，啊，通常我们自己啊打坐的时候呢，就要注意啊，任何一个念头都可以的啊。比如说，我们打坐的时候呢，啊，就留意自己的这个内心的活动啊。第一个，我们啊就。感觉或者是发现有一个念头啊冒出来的时候，比如说啊，我明天啊要赶时间啊去上班啊，或者是说我明天要去逛街啊，我要买个什么东西等等，这样子的念头一冒起来的时候呢，首先啊，一般的情况下我们就有了这个念头，我们不会去追究，不会去看它是什么。那但是这个锻炼的时候呢，首先啊，我冒出了一个这样子的念头的时候呢，然后我们要知道啊，我现在冒出了一个这样子的念头，我现在有一个这样子的念头在我的心里诞生了啊，要这样子去发现、发觉它。
So the first step is noticing when a thought arises in our mind. So the thought might be of needing to hurry tomorrow to be in time for work, or needing to go out and buy something. The important thing during this first step is simply to be aware, to notice the thought when it arises in our mind.
然后第二个步骤呢，我们发现它诞生了。第二个步骤就是诞生了以后呢，然后我们再去关注一下它往哪里走，它要干什么，然后去留意关注的时候呢，然后我们会发现它继续在想我明天要买个东西。买个什么样的东西啊？等等啊，然后呢，他在继续思考的时候呢，然后我们要发觉啊，他在思考啊，他存在，他还没有消失，他还在进行啊，这个思考啊，这个状态要发觉，要关注。
And the second stage is noticing or paying attention to.What this thought then continues to do. Does it continue to develop? For example, if my original thought was needing to go out and buy something, then does the thought continue to think about what it is, in fact, that needs to be bought? So the second stage is maintaining awareness of continuing to notice the thought and its operation.
比如说我们打坐的时候，或者是我坐在这个沙发上休息的时候呢，然后我们发现啊，有一只流浪猫或者一个流浪狗从这个门里面进来了，或者是有一个老鼠啊从某一个角落跑进来了，发现了，我看到了它。
So it's like when one is sitting on the couch and one notices that. the corner of the room, stray cat or dog or a mouse has entered the room.
然后看到了以后，哇！我第一次看到他出来的时候呢，然后我继续留意他往哪里走，他要干什么继续看。
And then I continue to keep an eye on where the cat or dog or mouse is going. So I have not only noticed it entering the room, but I continue to remain aware of where it is going.
同样的我们第一个要发现我们的这个念头诞生了。这个就是老鼠从门外进来了一样然后第二个呢，我们发现诞生了一个念头以后呢，然后我们继续关注它的这个活动这个就像我们发现这个老鼠进来以后呢，我们看它往哪里走跟这个一样的道理。
So, this idea of watching or noticing a mouse enter the room and then keeping an eye on it as it makes its way across the room, this is a metaphor for the way that we notice first the thought that arises in our mind and then remain continually aware of the process or the direction or the operation.
然后第三个步骤第三个步骤比如说老鼠进来了那我们发现了我们人稍微一动然后老鼠就发现这里有人然后它就会往回跑跑出去会这样子的那同样的就是有一个非常奇怪的现象奇怪的现象我们的这个内心的它的活动的方式是什么样子呢全部都是就暗中进行什么叫做暗中进行呢就像我们不留意它的时候呢它有太多太多的这个杂念满天飞的然后我们稍微关注一下它然后它立即就会间断的它会消失的大家可以回去感受一下
So, just as a mouse, as soon as it hears a sound, perhaps the sound of a human moving or something, has a start and then darts out of the room, so it is with our thoughts. When we observe them, or when they are observed, then they dissolve and disappear of their own accord. And this is an interesting phenomenon and one that everyone should try out for themselves.
然后当它消失的时候呢我们再进一步的去追究一下它消失到什么地方呢比如说老鼠一只流浪猫它出去了如果我们到门外去看我们还是可以看得到的它在外面的草地上但是我们的这个念头呢它去哪里呢它消失了以后呢我们进一步的去追踪要看个清楚
And then after the thought has disappeared, we continue to pursue it. We continue to follow where it was that the thought disappeared. So just as the animal, the mouse, who darts out of the room, we can go to the door and look for it and see that it's passed outside the door. Well, in the case of the thought that's disappeared, we simply look to see where it has dissolved.
我们去跟踪他的时候呢然后我们会发现他走了以后呢就是无影无踪的我们根本就不知道他去哪里了
When we do this we find when we follow that thought to try to find where it is it's disappeared to we discover that we can't know it's not possible to know where it is dissolved
然后他消失了以后呢我们效果比较好的时候我们会发现一个真相这个时候呢我们的这个前面的这个念头它消失了以后 然后我们会发现啊，这个我们的内在，我们的心啊，就像我们就看这个蓝天的时候一样啊，这个念头它是无影无踪的消失了，然后它消失了以后呢，它没有留下任何的痕迹啊，我们也没有找到任何的东西啊，就是一片虚空。
If we are able to follow the thought in a rather successful way, then we will find that after it has disappeared, that our mind is essentially like a very clear sky, and this is essentially where the thoughts appear.
韩传佛教的禅宗里面呢，有些时候这个叫做万里无云，万里晴。
So in
禅宗
，in the Chan tradition, this is referred to as 10,000 miles of clouds and 10,000 miles of clarity.
好，就是这样子啊，就是这个时候呢，我们就会发现，哎，我刚才很难受啊，很难过呀，那这个难过的这个念头啊，这感受怎么就不见了呢？啊，怎么就无影无踪了呢？会发现这样子的，会有这种感觉。
And in performing this noticing, we discover that.We just had a thought or a feeling of being unhappy or upset, and then by watching it and noticing it, it disappeared of itself into a state of a very calm state.
然后我们就觉得很奇怪啊，那然后又下一个念头，我们又去看看它到底什么样子，然后它的。诞生啊，然后它的存在，然后最后它的消失，这三个我们去感受，然后它又是跟这个一样，它又这样子无影无踪。
And then we do the same, and the next thought as it arises, we notice it's arising, we continue to notice how it behaves, and then we watch as it disappears.And it will do same as the first thought. It will disappear into nothingness.
然后我们平时有什么想不通的事情啊，让我们很难受这样子的时候呢，要就是要用这种方法。什么叫做想不通啊？想不通的念头出来的时候，就这三个步骤。去观察，然后呢，每一个念头，每一个念头，我们不观察的时候啊，我们刚才讲的暗中警醒，就是说我不留意的时候呢，然后比如说我什么都，我一动不动，在这个时候呢，然后这个老鼠就是满屋子跑啊，但我稍微有一点点动静的时候，它就往外跑一样，然后我们根本不管它的时候呢，然后什么难受啊、难过呀、太多太多的这些念头，让我们特别的疲惫啊，很辛苦。但是如果我稍微要注意一下它的时候，最后我们根本找不到它到底是个什么东西。
So, when we experience feeling very burdened by particular thoughts, then when we are able to sit down and bring our attention to this idea of being burdened or not being able to figure something out and pay attention to this as a thought, as a discursive thought, then we watch the arising of this thought, we notice how it progresses, and then we watch it disappear.
我们全世界每年有100万人去自杀。
In the world, every year there are 1 million people who commit suicide.
然后自杀未遂的、不成功的，大概就是有2000万。
And of these people, probably 200,000 do so for reasons of lack of success in their lives.
大家都是因为2000万，就是没有自杀没有成功的。
And 200,000 people
他们都是因为想不通某一件事情，就是这样子。
And all of these people are doing this because they cannot resolve a problem.
其实我们内在的很多东西是没有那么严重，只要有一点点方法是很容易调节很容易调整的。
In actual fact, the problems of our minds are really not as severe or as complicated as this. With just a few simple methods, it's possible for us to relieve ourselves of these states of mental affliction.
我们啊，要用这种方法去控制这个念头，不要让念头来控制我们。这个主动权就应该在我们人的手里。
So in terms of whether it's the thought that has control of us or whether we're in control of the thought, the power or the sovereignty, you might say, should be in our own hands.
虽然这个是一个很简单的这个训练的方法，但是在这个当中，如果我们前面的这些基础的部分做得好的话，那有可能我们真的是这个时候我们彻底的恍然大悟的了解我们的内在的世界是什么样子。
Even though what I just described is a simple practice.If we lay the foundations for this practice properly, the steps that I outlined earlier tonight, then it's entirely possible through working on this practice or by engaging in this practice that we may have an experience of a sudden realization of the nature of our minds.
如果我们彻底地了解了我们自己的内心的世界，那外在的世界非常容易了解，因为外在的世界是我们的内心的投影啊，或者是我们内心反射出来的东西，就像海市蜃楼一样的。
And if we can gain a penetrating understanding of the ultimate nature of our minds, then gaining a similar realization of the phenomena of the external world is a relatively straightforward matter. And that the reason for this is because the external world is in fact a projection of our minds. It's like a mirage or an illusion.
海市蜃楼，我们在空中啊，莫名其妙地看到很多的建筑物，还有人啊、车子呀、就整个的一个城市，我们可以空中看得出来。但是这个空中是没有这些东西的。
So in terms of a mirage-like vision of a city suspended in mid-air, we might apprehend this with our eye, but in actual fact, it doesn't exist.
但是我们在很远的地方可以找到一个。这个海市蜃楼的来源，这个城市有可能在很远的地方，因为这个光的折射在空气里面呢，我们就看到了一个它的这个整个的这个城市一模一样的东西，这是因为是光的折射的作用。
But it's possible that we might discover the reason for the illusion or the mirage. It could be through the way that light is functioning, or it might be a trick of light that creates the impression of the mirage.
哲学家在几千年都在争论这个外面的世界到底是精神还是物质，但是佛教说。它既不是物质，也不是精神，它就是我们内在的内心世界的一个投影，就像海市蜃楼一样。
So philosophers have been debating for thousands of years whether or not the external world is mind or whether it is matter. But from the point of view of Buddhism, it's neither mind nor matter. It's a rather a projection, a projected state of the mind.
啊，这个是我们需要详细的介绍的，但是我们没有时间，但是我想以后会有机会的。还有一个呢，我们可以在这个慧灯之光的网站上可以找到很多很多这方面的这个资料啊，有音频啊、视频啊都有，大家可以参考。那么这个它的作用是什么呢？当我们发现我们的内在的精神每一个啊这种痛苦难受等等这些问题啊，每一个都是无影无踪这样子的时候呢，然后我们的这个所有的这些内在世界内心的这些痛苦呢，我们就很容易自己就可以，我们不需要去找心理医生，不需要吃药，自己就可以解决了。
This is something that I would like to go into in more detail, but we unfortunately don't have enough time to do so. It is something, though, that I have described in quite a lot of detail in the Wisdom Life book series, and everybody can go to the website. There are video teachings and audio files that you can look at. In any case,The main point really is that by being able to notice our thoughts in this way, then it is possible for all of our negative emotions and negative thoughts, worry and anxiety and other negative thoughts, to resolve themselves. It's not necessary for us then to go and see psychologists deal with our problems.
现实生活当中的这些问题啊，仍然存在的，但是呢，这些问题就不会给我们，不会给我们带来啊很大的打击、创伤啊。那这样子也是非常好的，很有用的。
So even though our everyday problems and challenges will still continue to exist, they won't bring us the same acuteness of suffering.And so this is an extremely good thing.
那现实生活当中的这些问题呢，我们可以用世俗的方法去解决，或者是很多方法，很多的这些问题呢，我们可以不管它。
So, of course, in respect of these everyday problems and challenges, it is quite fine for us to resolve them or seek to address them.Using means, worldly means and worldly approaches. At the same time, too, through this ability to observe our minds, it's also an option for us not to pay them too much attention.
通过这种方法，我们很多的这些内心当中的这些问题都可以解决的。我们不能。想不通，什么事情再难的问题都通过这些方法，通过这种智慧去解决的话，都可以解决的。
Through the methods that I have described tonight, it's possible for us to address all of these problems of the mind. It's possible for them all to be resolved.
然后我刚才讲啊，这些念头最后消失无影无踪的时候呢，我们继续关注它的什么叫做无影无踪。这个时候呢，我们会发现我刚才讲的禅宗的这句话，意思就是说，它就证悟了佛教讲的空啊，佛教讲的空。
So when thoughts dissolve into this traceless state of nothingness, by paying attention to what this state in fact is, it's possible for us to realize or gain an understanding of what we describe in Buddhism as emptiness.
如果我们能够感受到佛教讲的这个空啊，那我们很多很多的烦恼，很多的问题，从本质上就可以解决。
And if we're able to realize or understand experientially this notion of emptiness, then many problems and difficulties in our life will be able to be resolved of their own accord.
我们有机会来听这个佛教的空行啊，有机会来修佛教的空性，这个确实是非常不容易的。
That we have the opportunity to learn about emptiness and to practice emptiness is in fact a very precious and rare thing.
在这个轮回当中啊，芸芸众生。无数无边的这个众生这样子的轮回当中，我们就是就这么一次找到一个这样子的机会是非常不容易的，大家都非常不容易。
That within the cycle of samsara, within the samsara itself, that we have found the opportunity here tohear these teachings and have the opportunity to practice them is a very special thing. It's not something that has come easily by any means.
前几天我们也讲过了啊，我们的生老病死啊，人生的这些重大的问题啊，最不能解决的这些问题呢，只有我们自己一个人独自去面对，这个时候我们的父母、我们的家人、我们的朋友，谁啊都帮不了我们。然后呢，我们辛辛苦苦一辈子啊，所积累下来的这些财富、物质财富也帮不上我们啊。那这个时候，如果我们没有一个这样子的方法去面对的话，那就是非常痛苦的事情。所以，希望大家珍惜啊这个机会。
So as we talked about last night, in respect of the basic sufferings of samsara, there is no one but ourselves who can address them. Our parents are not able to do it for us, our friends are not able to do it for us, our riches, our material possessions, they're not able to solve these basic sufferings. But in respect of dealing with sufferings,ourselves, we need a method, we need a technique. So I hope very much that everybody cherishes the teachings that we have received and are able to put them into practice.
我们每一个人的身心还有我们的生命啊，包括我们的生命都是非常的脆弱的啊，所以我们不要以为啊，我有钱我有地位啊，我年轻啊，没什么的，不怕啊，不能这样子。我们的这些身外的东西啊，其实就是在重大问题上，在人生的重大问题上，他们根本就帮不了我们。
So our minds and our bodies and indeed these very lives of ours are extremely fragile things.People should think, everyone should think, oh, I'm young, or I've got money, or I've got this, or I've got that. In respect of the ultimate challenges in the face of the ultimate sufferings of life, none of these things can be of any assistance.
强大自己的内心，提升自己的智慧，这个才是硬道理。
Only strengthening one's own mind and increasing one's own wisdom are the things that will be able to be.
Sonam de yi tam jo zu ba ni do ni ni pe zhe ne ba zhe ji ga na ji wa long zhe ba zhe bin zu lin zu wa zu le zhu om a hum ban zhe rung ge zhe.